Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Birmingham Literature Festival. It's great that so many of you could be with us on this lovely occasion. We love running the festival and we love bringing interesting writers together and we love creating interesting conversations, but it's really great when we got a full house to enjoy them. So it's thank you so much for coming out tonight. Before we get started, a few brief but very important thank yous. Our thanks, as ever, to Arts Council England, who support Writing West Midlands, who put on the Literature Festival. Without their support, we would not be able to bring writers from all over the world to come and discuss their books and ideas with you. So our great thanks to them. It's lovely to be in the Library of Birmingham, and it's lovely also to have Waterstones, our festival booksellers, popping up in the foyer. Libraries need booksellers as well as books to borrow, I think it's to say, and of course we have writers as well. This particular event has been supported by Greater Birmingham Chambers of Commerce. It's the first time we've worked with the Chambers of Commerce and they've been an absolute delight to work with, and we're so pleased that we have this opportunity to engage not just with readers and writers in the city but also with the business community, which is so important to us and to all of us. And this particular event is part of an initiative in association with the International Literature Showcase, which is supported by the British Council, the Arts Council and Writers Centre Norwich. Now, that particular initiative is a scheme to showcase the very best of writing conversations and writers around the world. So this event will be filmed, and next week from the 17th onwards will be available to literature-interested people in so many other countries around the world. It may surprise you to know not everyone realises how good a city Birmingham is. So this is an opportunity to share some of our most wonderful writers with those around the world, and we hope they will come to enjoy their work and also to come to Birmingham as well. Those are all my thanks. So now it's my great pleasure to introduce the event. We have with us the poets Benjamin Zephaniah and Liz Berry. They are both wonderful poets, deeply located in our city, in our region. And with them to lead the conversation is Professor of Language and Linguistics at Aston University and the Director of the West Midlands English Speech and Society Project, Ursula Clark. They will be talking about something which is close to all of our hearts if you live in this city, which is the language we use, the dialect we use, the accent we use, and how that shapes us and how it shapes how people see us. It's going to be a fascinating conversation. I'm going to now ask you to please welcome our three guests. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. It's a real privilege to be here this evening. I'm just going to say briefly, first of all, before we actually begin, the shape of this conversation. I'm going to give a brief introduction, then I'm going to talk, Liz and I will have a conversation, followed by Benjamin and I having a conversation, and then a three-way one, leaving about 20 minutes at the end for general questions from the audience. So if I just say a bit about myself, not very much. I mean, my interest in Birmingham and the Black Country accents began over 20 years ago when I started teaching English at Wolverhampton University. I was a university lecturer of English, and as part of a first year module, I used to get the students to write a linguistic autobiography. And then in talking to them about that linguistic autobiography, many of them spoke to me about their hesitance about talking in university seminars, because the way that they spoke, they said, didn't fit with the ways people spoke at university. And some even talked about being ashamed of their accent and dialect, particularly coming from Birmingham and the Black Country, which for some reason, I don't know why, seems to have this very negative public aspect to it. Even though linguists like myself spend a great deal of time and effort showing how differences between accents and dialects are just that, differences. They all have their linguistic patternings and regularities. But people's attitudes and opinions towards dialect use can be very different and rooted in emotion rather than fact. And it is true, most when linguists, very often they do these kind of experiments, asking people, people speak in different aspects, different accents, getting members of the public to judge their attractiveness or whatever, then typically always Birmingham and the Black Country come bottom. In fact, shockingly, the one piece of research that was done showed that it was better to remain silent than to open your mouth and speak with a Birmingham or Black Country accent. See ya. So that's led me into this area that I've been researching the past 20 years. So tonight we're joined, it's wonderful, by two immensely successful poets, whose work gives voice to and celebrates these very accents and dialects so vilified by others. And they're going to discuss for us this evening how the distinctive accents and dialects of Birmingham, the Black Country, have shaped and coloured their writing, which, of course, is intended to be spoken aloud. So, Benjamin Obadiah Iqbal Zephaniah needs no introduction here on my right. He was born and brought up in Aston, Lascelles, Handsworth areas of Birmingham, and on his website describes himself as poet, writer, lyricist, musician, and naughty boy. Should talk to you a bit more about that later, Benjamin. You've been protesting against injustice through your poetry and music and entertaining audiences for nearly 40 years, starting from your early days performing in Handsworth churches and youth clubs to London, where in the 1980s a small publishing house took a chance on you and published dub poetry, and your appearances on television happening soon afterwards, and an early film by Channel 4 also helping to promote your work nationally. Benjamin, of course, is also very well known abroad. His work took him away from the UK in the 1990s, he concentrated on performing outside Europe, and at one time performed in every continent over a 22-day period. And although your musical recording falls generally into the dub or reggae category, your recent album, Naked, defies categorisation, being a mixture of jazz, reggae, hip-hop, rock and house music. And then, of course, you're a best-selling children's poet. And you remain now, as then, as passionate about politics and poetry as you've ever been. Liz is born in the Black Country, lives in Birmingham. Your debut collection, Black Country, published by Chatto and Windus in 2014, was a Poetry Book Society recommendation, received a Somerset Maugham Award, won the Geoffrey Faber Memorial Prize and the Forward Prize for Best First Collection of 2014. Black Country was chosen as a Poetry Book of the Year by a raft of national newspapers, The Guardian, The Telegraph, The Mail, The Big Issue, and The Morning Star. And you now work as a tutor for the Arvin Foundation Writers' Centres Norwich and Writing West Midlands. And you've been a judge for awards, including the Forward Prizes for Poetry and Foyle Young Poets. So particularly, what is so wonderful about your poetry is that it's been recognised nationally, and that reviewers of your work comment upon your use of the vernacular, i.e. the dialect, its earthy, no-nonsense appeal. And you write in the Poetry Society's Young Poets Network, "When I first began writing poems in Black Country dialect, it was like digging up my own Staffordshire hoard. The area where I'd grown up, often mocked for its dialect, turned out to be a field of spectacular words, sounds and phrases. Everywhere I looked, the stuff of poetry was glinting out of the muck. The old words are the best. They have an integrity, a patina, like a quirky handful of coins." So Kate Kellaway, in her Observer review of Black Country, said, "This is the glinting hoard that Berry has brought so gleefully to the surface. Unlikely, obdurate forms that yet have worn well and rubbed nicely together with other, more conventional idioms." So my first question to you, Liz, is what led you to view these words, sounds and phrases associated with the Black Country accent and dialect as glinting out of muck?
The Black Country in the Birmingham area is traditionally associated with the subterranean, with hard work, with tough work, with industry, blackness, filth, muck, all these beautiful, amazing words. But also it's in possession of this really fantastic, magical dialect. Only I suddenly realised that nobody beyond the region seemed to be appreciating that. It had these really negative connotations. But when I started plucking these words out and looking at them, these amazing words like Donny and Jack Squalor and Donkey Bite, they were just shining. And the more I lifted them up to the light, the more they seemed to shine and gleam. And it felt like a real discovery to be able to bring them out and show them to people, this beautiful thing we'd been hiding.
So you say of your Black Country volume, "I wanted to tell a story about the place where I grew up. In many ways, the book is a love letter to the Black Country." So what is it, do you think, that makes the Black Country so distinctive and that makes you want to write a love letter to it?
I think for me it's because it's home. It's the place where I grew up and where my family's from. And so that gives it a special kind of pull and magic. But also what I think is really exciting about the region is that it hasn't really been mythologised yet.
What do you mean by that?
There's not many stories told about it. There's not many poems written about it. There's not songs sung about it. It's a bit of an undiscovered gem. In fact, when I've sort of travelled around doing readings for the book, a great majority of people have never heard of the Black Country. They don't know where it is. They've got no idea. And that's quite exciting as a writer because you can make things up. You can say what you like.
That's very true. So why do you think there is so much negativity and prejudice about the accent and dialect of the Black Country?
I don't know, because I genuinely think it's beautiful. I remember going to university, I stood up in Scotland, and I didn't know I had an accent. Until the first day, and somebody said to me, "Where are you from?" And I said, "Oh, I'm from Dudley." And this girl went, "Oh, I am sorry." Just about broke my heart, really, because I remember living away from home at various points in my life, and then in the street or in a pub or in a cafe, hearing somebody with that accent or ringing my nan or coming home, and it just sounded so beautiful for me, so sort of tied to that particular place.
So it didn't make you want to change the way you spoke at all? Because that's the other thing that happened.
No, sort of the opposite, really. It kind of made me more determined to celebrate it as this lovely thing that actually we should be proud of. That's the only way that you can change negative perceptions of your accent or your region, is when you go out there and you make beautiful songs or poems or art, or you perform, or you're sort of an ambassador for your region and your language in the world.
So you say you've drawn inspiration from the use of dialect by other poets, particularly Scottish poets such as Kathleen Jamie and Katrina Porteous, Billy Letford. What is it that particularly about them that inspired you?
I think it's the way that they take vernacular language, something traditionally associated with sort of ordinary people, with the voices we have every day, the voices we have at work, and they use it in a really different context. They make these beautiful poems out of it. Sometimes they use it in a really delicate way, this rare, treasured, poetic language. Other times it's funny, or a bit rude, or irreverent, or saucy, or playful. It just seems to bring this incredible liveliness to the work, and that was something I really admired.
Yeah, because it is that earthiness, isn't it? It is about the everyday. But one particular aspect of your work is in the exploration of gender roles and identity, and connecting that with your interest in dialect, which is both serious and joyous and in places defiant, and about subversive sensuality. Why do you have this? What is this particular exploration? Why is it important to you in your work to explore this aspect of human behaviour?
I think I'm really interested in sensuality in sort of the broadest sense in my work. Often sensuality is a sort of a word with a bad rep. If we kind of think of candles and romance and sensual moments, but actually I think of sensuality as something that heightens or excites your senses. It's about that animal bit of you. Sorry, baby, this... Shut your ears. and I think that's something I'm really fascinated by in my work, that interplay between human and animal and our sort of less tidy selves, and especially in the context of women as well, and women's sensuality, women's identities.
So what would you identify as being subversive about that?
Well, I never think it is particularly subversive, but other people do say it's subversive, and I think it's because, really, still in this day and age, we're not especially used to hearing women, I think, talk frankly and openly and curiously about sensuality, about their bodies, about their identity, about the fluidity of things like gender and relationships. So I think maybe that's the subversive bit. And sometimes it's a bit naughty, probably, so that too.
So you're going to read us a couple of poems.
Let's find something good. I'll read one of those slightly naughty poems. This poem's called So, and it's a dialect poem, so it uses lots of those beautiful words, and it's also this idea about gender. And I wrote it after I caught a girl in the changing rooms at the swimming baths, who I think thought she was by herself in there, stepping onto the weighing scales, and then saying to herself in this really awful, pained voice, "You fat pig." And my heart just hurt for her, and I couldn't stop thinking about her. And so I wanted to go home and write a poem that would just transform her and that moment into something incredibly naughty and rebellious, a little pig that could stick all its trotters up. So here she is. So, dainty footwear turns a young lady into an altogether more beautiful creature. Eliza Sell, Etiquette for Ladies. Trottering down the horse road in me new hooves, I'm farmyardy sweet. Fresh from the filth of straw and swill, the trembly leg sniff of the slaughter wagon. A guzzler, gilt, trollopy and canting. Root your tongue beneath me frock and gulp the brute stench of the sty. I've stopped denying myself, nibbling grateful as a pet on baby leaves, a fiat of the glutton of belly and rump. I've sunk, and when lads hoed out apples on soft city palms, I guttle and spit, for I need a mon wi' a body like a trough of tumbly slop to bury me snout in. All them soft years of hiding at home, them prancing like a pony for some sod to bridle and shove down the pit, shying away from his dirty fists. All them nights, me eyes rolling white in the dark, when the sow I am was biting and squaling to get out. Now no mon dare scupper me, nor fancy horse bints, for I've kicked the fence, and I'm roiling on me back in the muck, out of me mind with grunting pleasure, trotters pointing to the heavens like chimney pots, sticking V to the cockerel, prissy and crowing on his high church spire.
Can you read us another one?
Oh, I'll read something a bit more delicate. Oh, I can tell the crowd now that I've heard that. This is another dialect poem, but a dialect used in a really different way, that sort of delicate way that I was talking about. It's a poem called Birmingham Roller. And if you've not seen the Birmingham Roller before, it's a beautiful kind of fancy tumbling pigeon that was originally bred in the Birmingham and the Black Country. And because it's a tumbling pigeon, it performs this beautiful trick. It tumbles backwards and down. And just when there's this awful moment that you think it's just going to fall out of the sky, it swoops back up and joins all the birds in its kit. And as soon as I saw the roller tumble, I just was in love with it, and it seemed this beautiful symbol of the region, but more specifically its language. This really ordinary grey-looking little bird hiding a very spectacular trick under its wing. Birmingham Roller. We spent our lives down in the blackness. Those birds brought us up to the light. Jim Shell, tumbling pigeons in the Black Country. Wench, you're the colour of our town. Concrete, steel, oily rainbow of the cut. There were streets amid your wings. There were factory chimneys, the plumes on your chest. Your heart's the china, our road girls dust in their tranquilment cabinets. Bread to dazzling. Backyards. By men whose arms grew soft as feathers just to touch you. To cradle you from egg through each death-defying tumble. Little acrobat of the terraces. Wind-winged when we gaze at you. Jimmicking the breeze. Somersaulting through the white breath prayer of January. And rolling back up like a babby's yo-yo. Caught by the open donny of the clouds.
So that's what you mean by getting the glint out of the muck, yeah. Which is wonderful.
Thank you.
And it's unusual to have a woman championing dialect writing and dialect poetry. Why do you think that is?
That's such an interesting question. Because actually some of the poets that I really admire that use dialect are contemporary women poets, but it's quite a new thing.
Yes.
I wonder if it's because vernacular speech has been so traditionally associated with sort of working people and ordinary people and sort of the world of outdoors. Whereas women, I think historically, have often been striving to be seen as proper and ladylike. And especially women writers have had to fight hard to be taken seriously. And so I suppose it's the privilege of my generation of women writers. Lots of brilliant hard work has gone before me, so I can use those old forms and play with those and be bold enough to take them on, because people have paved a brilliant pathway for me to get there.
Yeah, I think that's true. Yes, that's a lot to be... Yes, that's right. Yeah, because there is... what I find quite fascinating is, I was saying to Benjamin before, that, you know, people predicted that accents and dialects would die out as people became increasingly more educated to ever longer ages, that we'd all speak the same. But that hasn't happened, has it? It's actually in a sense that people want to keep an affinity with where they came from. They might have changed social class through education, but they still want to have an identity that links them to where they came from. Would you say that is something part of what you're doing?
Yeah, and it's something I see more and more with young poets and performers. You know, when I go to readings and festivals and events, it's really beautiful because you hear people speaking in lots of different voices, accents, playing with different vernaculars, with home languages, with second languages. Yeah. I think that's a really exciting thing for poetry.
Yeah. It is. Benjamin. So, you say you can't remember a time when you weren't creating poetry. And it had nothing to do with school, and school meant very little to you. And you left at 13. So what was your school experience like? Why did school not touch you in any way in terms of a love of poetry or literature?
Wow, I could talk about this all night, but I won't. Various reasons. One was, the out and out racism that I experienced in some schools. The first school I went to wasn't very far from here. It was called Zephaniah in Farm Street in Newtown. And I can remember me and my twin sister, on the first day we went there, to celebrate our arrival, the teacher told the rest of the kids to go home and bring back the next day their favourite gollywog. And that's how they celebrated our arrival. So you got all these kids with these gollywogs going to me and my sister, "Does that look like your dad?" And you go, "Yeah." It was a terrible kind of experience. And the strange thing was, my mum was living in Aston, which was very mixed.
Yeah.
Then it was kind of mainly Caribbean people and Irish people. Mm. And but she sent us to the school in Huckley because she thought it was kind of moving up the social ladder because it was an all-white school. But I mean, it was like the poorest white people in Europe. But she still thought it was moving up the social ladder. So I had a difficult time there. Then she took me out of there, sent us to a school called Deakin Avenue in Witten. It was the complete opposite. You know, the teachers are kind of creative, and they heard me kind of making rhymes and doing poetry. And sometimes I did it in assembly. They'd go, you know, come up and do a poem for us.
How old were you then?
Oh, it's kind of junior school, so you're 6, 7, 8, something like that. I didn't call it poetry. I used to call it just playing with words at the time. And I remember kids used to have this game. I don't know if you've played it. It's called Kiss Chase.
Oh, yes. Hasn't everybody?
So, you know, you count to close your eyes, count to 10, and the girl runs off, and then you've got to find her and kiss her. And I did like sport, but sometimes I just got lazy, and I thought, I don't want to run after girls. So I just said, right, I used to go to girls and say, tell me your name, and I'll make up a poem about you. and I get a kiss for that. That's the naughty bit in my autobiography.
No, you don't get away with it that quick.
And then I went to various schools. The family kind of broke up and got very kind of dysfunctional. Is not the word really. It was worse than that. You know, we got mixed up and yeah, it's complicated. But I went to a school which was called Canterbury Cross, and then it was called the Broadway. And any Broadway kids here?
A Broadway teacher.
Right. Oh, well, in the 80s, that was after my time. But, the teachers, when they kicked me out of the Broadway, the teacher said to me, you are a born failure. She said, you're going to end up in prison doing a life sentence, or you're going to end up dead, because I started getting involved in kind of crime and stuff. And a couple of them turned up at my concert. And they come round the backstage and they say, can you tell Benjamin Zephaniah, we used to be his teachers, can we get on the guest list? So I kind of sent a message back saying, piss off. And I said to the organisers, charge them extra. But I spoke to them afterwards and we had a good laugh about it. Look, I mean, I was really dyslexic, and teachers didn't understand dyslexia at that time, so I don't blame them for it. Mm. You know, I remember a teacher telling me that, telling the class that it's a history lesson, this happened and that happened, and then Christopher Columbus went and discovered black people. And I was the kid that would get up and say, what, we didn't exist until Christopher Columbus discovered us, you know, and then I'd be told to shut up, and then I wouldn't shut up, you know. And, so, you know, there was that, and then... when I got excluded from school, we just kind of got left on the streets. There wasn't pupil referral units like there is now. Mm. And so we just got left on the streets, and we just got in trouble with the police and all kinds of things. You know, we went into cafes and whatever. But I always had a love of poetry, and we used to kind of hang out with sound systems. For those of you that don't know, you know, these are kind of big sound systems, massive speaker boxes like this, kind of really big. We got any old blues people here? Yeah, right. Everybody had to put their hand up. I'm related to them. So we're listening to a lot of reggae, and what people don't realise with reggae music is that there's a lot of poetry in it.
Oh, yes.
I mean,
yes.
Real reggae. I'm not talking about the kind of ragga stuff. A lot of stuff came out in the late 80s, which was very sexist and very aggressive. But before that, it was very political, it was very poetic, and it was very political. When I started performing, apart from the stuff I did in the playground, it was on sound systems.
Yeah.
We used to call it toasting, they would call it freestyling now. And I went on various sound systems in Birmingham. There were some which were kind of really small and not known that well, one called Merry Tone. There was another one called Quaker City that I toasted on sometimes, and Christopher, Mafia Torn Hi-Fi. And I loved it because you'd just be toasting, and somebody walks in the room, you just kind of improvise and talk about the person in the room. And I made my name for kind of talking about things that were in Birmingham. Most people were mimicking what was going on in Jamaica.
Right. Mm.
So I was talking about what happened today in Birmingham. Mm. And I didn't really think of myself as political. I was just kind of writing about my situation. And again, what a lot of people don't understand when they look at reggae and they think it's political, you know, when Bob Marley was asked why is his work so political, he didn't understand the question. He said, I'm just writing about the conditions I live in.
Yeah.
I'm just writing about my reality. So that's where my poetry comes from. It really is, you know, academics use this term all the time, but for us it's a living thing. It really is the oral tradition. When I first encountered poetry from Louise Bennett and these other Jamaican poets and Caribbean poets, it was hearing them.
Yeah.
You know, we didn't read them.
No.
In fact, I remember the time when some people protested that, you know, our poetry shouldn't be written down because it would kill it, it would fix it.
Yeah.
And Nancy's story is supposed to move at the times and be changeable. You know, and if computer is invented, you just change the story slightly to incorporate computers. Once it's set and written down, and people start teaching it as it's written down, it's kind of stuck in the past. So I forgot what the question was, but that's my answer.
So, but you have, like, I mean, you touched a bit on that about being strongly influenced by music and the street poetry of Jamaica.
Mm.
But did you go back to Jamaica when you were growing up? Where did this sense of Jamaica,
well,
did it continue in your life?
I went back to Jamaica kind of, I mean, I was kind of growing up. But Handsworth then was like an outpost of Jamaica. Mm-hmm. You know, everybody spoke Jamaican. Even our white friends spoke Jamaican. You know, everybody spoke. And like I said, there was a lot of Irish people there.
Yeah.
The Asian community started moving in, you know. We had Asian friends, and they spoke Jamaican. You know, people may know Apache Indian, people like that. You know.
Yeah.
When he went to music, he went in a kind of Jamaican style.
Yeah.
I remember my mother telling me that a relative was coming from Jamaica when I was quite small, and coming to see us in England. And I just kind of went to a park, Handsworth Park, and just got a high bit, and I went to the high bit, and I thought I'd see my uncle coming over the horizon, because I thought Jamaica was just over there. You know, we were so Jamaican at the time. So it was just natural for us to use the Jamaican, I call it a language. Some people won't say it's a language, but, you know, you have people who say it's a language in its own right. But it's just the way we spoke. And there's something really beautiful about it when it comes to expressing, you know, Michael Smith, I don't know if you know Michael Smith, this poet, he wrote a poem called Me Can't Believe It. And the way he used to perform it, I don't know it all word for word, but he went something like, me can't believe it, Mr. Me can't believe it. Room for rent, I apply with him, but as I move in, rat, cockroach, and scorpion also move in. La, Mr. Me can't believe it. Now, if you ever hear Jamaican women talking in the marketplace,
oh, yeah,
and they say, girl, they're pregnant again, la. It just captures it. Now, after Michael Smith died, Lynton Kwesi Johnson and a couple of other people wrote his poetry down. Now, how do you capture that? When he performed, you would see the anguish on his face. When you see it written, it just goes, Lard, L-A-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-D. So it's really an expressive language. And I was watching a film of mine the other day, the film you mentioned, actually, which Channel 4 made in the early 80s. And I was looking at it, and I thought, first of all, I look much older than I am now. I can't be getting younger. And I sounded older. And I sounded much more Jamaican. And something struck me once. This is when I went to London. It was in the times of the riots and stuff like that. And I did a television interview. And I was basically kind of speaking Jamaican. And somebody said, you know, what are you going to... what do you think the community should do? And I said, well, you know, Babylon have to burn. Right now, we have to burn down the Babylon then. And the headline in the paper said, Benjamin Zephaniah incites riot, calls on the people to burn Buckingham Palace. You know, some journalist has gone to the dictionary and went, what does Babylon mean?
So it was the move to London when your career really took off, didn't it? When you moved there in the 80s and from then onwards, would you say?
Yeah, I was really lucky in a sense that when... The thing was, when I was in Birmingham, I was in trouble with the police all the time and there was kind of gangs and guns started to come on the scene and stuff like that. And, you know, I remember what the teacher said, I'm going to end up dead or doing a life sentence, and I thought, I've got to prove that teacher wrong.
So she did you and, some good then?
Yeah. And... I went to London in a Ford Escort. I ran away with my friend's girlfriend, Astro from UB40. I nicked his girlfriend. I don't know why I'm telling you all this. Well, they said I should open up. Well, they were rehearsing. I went to them. I said, "This." They wasn't calling you before today. They didn't have a name. I said, "They're not going anywhere." You know, me and I got London, and we're going to become a big poet. You know, and I said, "Do you want to come?" She went, "Yeah, yeah." Okay. And then we were in London. And after a few months, we were watching television, and UB40 came on the television. I am a one in ten, and the girl said, "I'm just going to the bathroom." I never saw her again. Went back to UB40. But when I went to London, I found another gang, basically. I was really lucky. I met a guy called Roland Muldoon, who was passionate about a thing called alternative cabaret. And he used to put on these shows, Rick Mayall, Dawn French, Jennifer Saunders. We wanted to do a movement against all the comedy that was going on with sexist and racist stuff, a new variety. Kind of. So people come on and do juggling, then a poet would come on, then a singer would come on. And, I remember working with Julian Clary when he was called Joan Collins Fan Club.
Joan Collins Fan Club, I remember that.
Keith Allen, Lily Allen's father, and another brother called Tony Allen. We were all kind of doing this stuff because... You know, and the demonstrations were happening every week then, you know. Every week we'd be at the demonstration performing. Everything came together, the politics, the poetry, people wanted alternative poetry. You know, you were talking about hearing different accents. I remember at one point in the mid-80s, a man saying to me, I am English, I'm white, I'm heterosexual and I'm male, and nobody wants to listen to my poetry. I said to him, we've been listening to your poetry for hundreds of years, and now we want to hear different accents, we want to hear from the lesbians, we want to hear from the blacks, we want to hear from everybody else. You're in there, but you're a minority group, man. So it was an interesting time.
Yes, yes. But even though you went to London and you developed a career internationally, Birmingham has still been very important to you, hasn't it?
Always. And the strange thing was, when I left Birmingham, I kind of didn't care about it. I guess it's because I was getting in trouble so much and I didn't really think about it. I missed some of my friends and stuff like that. But when I went to London and they started taking the mickey out of my accent and mocking people from Birmingham, I used to get into fights, all kinds of things, you know, defending Birmingham. And when it comes to defending Aston Villa, my God. It just got really heavy and I became more... Is there a word for, like, if you're passionate about England, you call patriotic. Is there a word for your city? We should invent one.
Yeah, that's true.
Next challenge.
But I became more passionate about Birmingham. Yeah. And I just felt I had to... And I do love the city. I do love the people here. And the main reason why I left was the gang and crime culture that I was in. And when I started to perform my poetry in theatres, I performed in about 2 theatres that would allow me to perform in them.
In London, was this?
In Birmingham.
In Birmingham.
Yes. It's difficult to understand now, but we were living in Handsworth. If we came into what we call town, the city centre, at the middle of the night, we get stopped, we get searched, we have to get into a fight. So the idea of me going and asking to perform at, you know...
Here?
Yeah. It just out of the question. So when I went to London, the punk thing was happening, punk and reggae was coming together. But I still love Birmingham. And I love it even more after I left, oddly enough. Which is, I find interesting because, I mean, I've always felt of myself as an internationalist, actually, you know. I feel like I could live everywhere. And I care about the people of Iraq just as much as I care about the people of Birmingham and the people of Afghanistan or Jamaica or whatever. But when I come to Birmingham, it doesn't matter where I've been and it doesn't matter where I'm living, I always go coming home. And for me, it's there are a couple of things, although it's changed. Fort Dunlop.
Oh, yes, yes.
When I come over that motorway and then Villa Park, but that's getting a bit depressing. But, and there's a couple of other landmarks. It depends on what way I'm coming in. But I go, I'm home. I go home to my mum and she says, where's the money? I'm home.
But that's what you said, Liz, isn't it, about your poetry, but it's about home and about the area and the region.
Yeah, and it's really interesting because actually I didn't start writing about the Black Country until I moved away. We lived away for a while. And then it's sort of, you can look back down the telescope at it and it's fascinating in a new way. Sometimes when you're just there in the region, living your life, working, doing whatever you do, you don't see what's special about it or interesting.
And we were talking about this earlier because this is the first time I've met you. But your publisher sent me your book. And I can't remember what I wrote back, but I wrote something back because I was so moved by it. And I realised that I'd never seen or read people like this on the page. And, like, this is like taking me home. So I never thought of it, you know? It's just... Because I kind of grew up, and this is a sad thing to say, but it's true. I kind of grew up thinking there's, you know, white poetry and black poetry. And the white poetry that they tried to teach me at school didn't have anything to do with the reality of my life. It was all dead white male poets. And the first white poets I heard that were living were, you know, Attila the Stockbroker and Stephen Wells, the punk poets, John Cooper Clarke, and then people like Roger McGough. When I did a gig in the Royal Albert Hall, me and Allen Ginsberg fooled the Royal Albert Hall, just the two of us. And I didn't know who Ginsberg was. And the day of the gig, I said to somebody, yeah, I'm playing at Royal Albert Hall. And I didn't like playing there because it said Royal. And they were saying, it's great, you've packed out the Royal Albert Hall. I got this guy supporting me called Ginsberg. Ginsberg! And then I realised there was another world of white. I don't like to put colour labels on it, you know what I mean? But it was because the way we grew up. We called ourselves dub poets, reggae poets. And the white guys I knew called themselves punk poets and everything. Because of the kind of image that poetry had. And if we went back to Handsworth and just went, we're a poet, they'd go, sure. So we had to kind of prefix it with something so that people would identify it, you know.
So why do you think it is still that the Birmingham accent and dialect gets such a negative press, either of you? Why is it?
I think one important thing is the way that it's presented in the media.
Yeah.
Because if you listen to mainstream media or TV, you really seldom hear like a positive representation of the accent. It's always kind of a comedy accent, kind of associated with characters who are a bit thick.
Yeah.
And I think that's a really negative thing. Even on adverts and stuff like that, if you hear an accent from the Midlands, it's rare for it to just be, you know, a regular character. So maybe that's something to do that perpetuates it anyway.
Yeah.
I remember many years ago, this is not really an answer to the question, it just reminded me of it. I remember many years ago doing an interview with somebody, I think from The Guardian, and she mentioned the Birmingham accent. And I said, it's beautiful. I said, have you ever made love to somebody with a Birmingham accent? And she went, well, you've got to try it, you know. And it was in the early days of Twitter. It just said Twitter and I love it. I've got to find somebody from Birmingham. Benjamin Zephaniah looks okay on it. I want to try it.
Sound advice.
It's an interesting one. I was the guest. The guest producer, director of the Today programme. They do that at the end of the year.
Yes.
And one of the things I did, I don't know if anybody heard it, I made sure they got lots of accents on it.
Yeah.
And it kind of sounded beautiful. When people said, and I'm not just bigging up the Birmingham accent, I'm bigging up, you know, Geordie, I love them all. I lived in Liverpool for a couple of years, I love the Liverpool accent. Once they started doing that, getting people to announce things on Radio 4 at that time in the morning, almost any other accent apart from the, is it called RP that they use?
Yeah.
Whatever it's called. Sounded like music. Mm. You know, people would just go, I'm not going to try and imitate a Geordie accent. Or that. But they would say something that's really normal in a Geordie accent and it sounds so nice, you know?
Yeah.
I've got to say this, that I'm really passionate about multiculturalism. And I think one of the problems with multiculturalism is that people seem to associate it with black and Asian cultures coming to Britain. Before black and Asian people come here, Britain was multicultural.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there was this particular tribe, the Burma tribe, that settled Birmingham. You know, when they settled Birmingham, the Saxon tribes around them go, what another bunch of people. Why do they have a thing called a bull ring? You know, why do they keep bulls like that? You know, the Celts, the Silas, the Jutes, all these people came and added to the culture of Britain. And that's what I really like celebrating. And you've got loads of people, you know, fighting their corner, bigging up their accents, and now it's Benjamin Zephaniah and Liz Berry.
Thank you both. So now it's time for your time. Questions from the audience. Anybody got any questions they'd like to put? Yes, at the back up there.
The most difficult position to get to. What, have you only got one mic? It's so low budget. There's one mic for.
Benjamin, you said you knew the Apache Indian. How well do you... And did you ever meet him, or...?
Yes, yes.
He never told me.
Sorry?
He never told me.
He never told you?
No.
Oh, we actually made a film together many years ago, and it's really interesting. I was watching it the other day, and it was so interesting. We were talking about black people in... black and Asian people being in commercials at the time. The idea of just a black person just selling a washing machine just for the sake of it. We were always edgy, doing hip-hop or something like that. And it was about the kind of nervousness of advertising people to put black people in commercials and how music has been kind of informed by all these different people that have come here. So, yeah, I mean, I didn't know him very, very well, but I knew him pretty well. We did a couple of things together. I remember once we were in India, we were not very far from each other, but we kept communicating with each other by kind of email or something. But I haven't seen him for a while. Is he free or is he in jail?
He's in. He spends Wednesdays. He's opened an academy down in Handsworth.
Right.
He has a music academy for Black and Asian youth for the college.
Good.
So yeah.
Thank you.
I'm waiting for another question, but
there's one here.
Oh.
And Benjamin, did you both watch Peaky Blinders? And do you think Peaky Blinders sexed up the Birmingham accent a little bit more?
Did we watch it?
Benjamin's in it.
I've never seen it.
Do you think it sexed up the Birmingham accent a bit more?
Sorry?
Do you think the Peaky Blinders sexed up the Birmingham accent a bit more?
I do know this. When Peaky Blinders was first, I was the first person cast for it. The writer said when he's writing my part, he knew that it was for me. And I'm probably the only person in Peaky Blinders, although I only do a cameo, I only appear every now and again when I'm free. Because I don't get out of my bed for more than 50 grand. it's based on a real person. There was this Caribbean, this Jamaican man who fought with them, really fought with a battalion from Birmingham in the First World War. Oh. He went home and he missed the people of Birmingham so much that he came and he lived here. And he ended up being a street preacher. They used to call him Jimmy Jesus. If you ever see a script of Peaky Blinders, he's called Jimmy Jesus in it. But on the screen, I'm called Jeremiah Jesus. And that was a legal problem with the family. They said you can't use the term Jimmy Jesus. Anyway, I'm giving away state secrets here. Now, when the programme first came out, like any TV series, we don't know how it's going to be, how successful it's going to be. And I was the only person from Birmingham in the whole programme. And I mean that, even the extras. You know what I mean? I was the only person from Birmingham. And I remember when the first programme went out, people on Twitter were saying, you know, isn't it interesting that the only real Brummy on there is a Brummy of Jamaican parentage? but I know this much. The BBC are really scared of making dramas with Birmingham accents.
Yeah.
They're really scared of it because Birmingham people complain when they don't get it right.
People can what?
Complain.
Oh.
They really complain, right? But they told me something which I think is really telling. They said that when they do use it, especially if it's a series of programmes, and it happened with Peaky Blinders, the first episode gets a lot of complaints about the accents. The second gets smaller and smaller. And if the programme and the storyline is good, by the third, people stop thinking about the accent and they get into the drama.
Yeah.
And that's exactly what happened with Peaky Blinders.
Yeah. What do you think, Liz? Do you think it's
I thought
it's...
it was great, wasn't it? Blimey. And there was something amazing about a programme that was incredibly cool, brilliant music, beautifully shot. Remember that just seeing the first episode and that opening scene where
that
comes in on a horse? Mm. We were just absolutely wowed by it. And I think you're right, there was a few dodgy accents. Yeah. But actually, I think it made people see Birmingham in a different way. And I went to hear the director give a talk about it. And he was saying he wanted to do something that he'd not seen done before. He wanted to mythologise Birmingham, make it into this sort of hyper-real mythological place, you know, sort of this Wild West. And it was amazing. I thought a really amazing impact.
What a lot of people here don't understand is how big it is all around the world.
Yeah.
You know, yes. Snoop Dogg wants to be in it now. Seriously. He wants to be in it, seriously. You know, so we've done the Peaky Blinders takeover Birmingham. And then on the second series, they go down to London and take on a Jewish gang.
That's right. That's
and then on the third, they take over the Russians. I suggest that we do a bit of ganja dealing in Jamaica. You know, we could film Peaky Blinders in Jamaica.
There's a question here, the gentleman in the middle of the row here, third row.
Have I missed something?
Oh, here's the mic.
Have I missed something, Peaky Blinders?
Yes.
What channel is it on?
You don't know what it is?
Well, I've heard of it, but I haven't watched it.
You only have to.
It's very good. Well, it sounds it.
Well...
I must catch up. Can I watch it on catch-up?
I couldn't possibly comment. Apparently, it's okay.
Yes, the lady in the black and red checked shirt.
It's given amazing pride to Birmingham, though.
Yes, yes, yes.
It's a question for Liz, in fact. To pick up on one of the things you'd said about the accent, and you said it just wasn't something that you heard kind of rejoiced in. There's some really interesting local folk clubs that have been singing and using and singing in black country dialect. And I wonder whether you'd been aware of those, because what's interesting is, you know, when you meet people who've been singing in it for years, you know, really precious old songs that connect with the kind of the industrial history. And so in a sense, it's being carried on and celebrated through folk music. Were you aware of that?
No, not really, because...
What a shame.
Yeah, I've listened to lots of folk music from other regions, but never really heard much from Birmingham or the Black Country. We had a beautiful book, I think compiled by John Raven, which was folk songs from the Black Country with just the music and the words. That's the closest I've ever kind of really got to it. But it'd be lovely, come and chat to me after and tell me more if you know more about it, because we'd love to hear some.
Thank you. This gentleman here and then the lady at the back.
I've got the mic already. Do you mind if I...
Oh, yeah, OK, you've got the microphone, yeah, and okay. Then the gentleman here, yeah.
Hi, I have a question for both of you about the embodiment of poetry. It strikes me that both of your works are very much anchored in the body, and they seem to get, you know, they seem to have a life that kind of, you know, stages the body in some way, or that relies on the body. Are you aware of writing to give voice to a kind of body, whether it's marginal or, I don't know, gendered, or do you have a sense of writing through the body or for a body of some kind?
It's a really interesting question. I'm trying to think of a good way to do it justice. I think perhaps that's something that we touched on a bit in the discussion. For me personally anyway, this awareness about the body and I suppose my interest particularly in women's bodies and children and the physical aspect of that, sort of the sensuality, this idea of sensuality and of our bodies in the world. I think that's probably the way it comes out in my poetry and also in performance, I think, something as well. When you perform your poetry, there's then the you in your body has to then interact with the rest of the world and the words. That wasn't a very good answer, I'm so sorry.
What about you, Benjamin?
When I write, is it something very special, and that can be negative or positive, that's moved me to write? So I tend to, especially the poems that I perform, usually are written very quickly. Something hits me, there's something I've got to get out, and I've got to get it out. And sometimes I write it down, sometimes I'll just kind of repeat it in my head and just form it in my head. When I then come to reproduce it, if you like, perform it, I go back to that point, that emotion that I had originally. And usually it will involve my body. Sometimes when I'm writing, I know exactly what I'm doing with my hands, how I'm moving around the stage. I know where it's coming from, if it's coming from deep in my stomach, if it's coming from the throat. And I think there's a difference because I write poetry for performance. There are some pieces that are not, but most of all, I write poetry for performance. So, you know, writing a poem like Wrong Radio Station, for example, I was looking at the media, looking how the media were telling lies and how sometimes people were believing the lies and how we were going to war on lies and things like this. And I wrote some words. Now, this is not how they came to me, but this is how they would come if I were just reading them. My ears are battered and burned, and I have just learned that I have been listening to the wrong radio station. My mind has been brutalized. Now the pain can't be disguised. I've been listening to the wrong radio station. I was beginning to believe that all black men were bad men and white men would reign again. I was beginning to believe that I was a mindless drug freak that couldn't control my sanity or my sexuality. I was beginning to believe that I couldn't believe in nothing except nothing. And all I ever wanted to do was to get you and to do you. I've been listening to the wrong radio station. But that's not how I felt at the time. How I felt at the time was, my ears are battered and burnt, and I have just learned that I have been listening to the wrong radio station. My mind has been brutalized now, the pain can't be disguised. I've been listening to the wrong radio station. I was beginning to believe that all black men were bad men and white men would reign again. I was beginning to believe that I was a mindless drug freak that couldn't control my sanity or my sexuality. I was beginning to believe that I couldn't believe in nothing except nothing, and all I ever wanted to do was to get you and to do you. I've been listening to the wrong radio station. Yeah. So I tell my students this, go back to the emotion that you had when you wrote it. And I remember once a friend of mine, well, a guy I kind of mentored before I was in university, just a guy from the street, if you like, he was being bullied. And I helped him get a book published by a small publisher. And we were in Cambridge at Waterstones, and he had to do a reading, and it was his first ever reading. And he was standing there very nervous, and I said to him, remember, this whole book is about bullying, and it's something he felt passionate about. And I said to him, do you remember how you felt when you wrote these poems? Do you remember what you wanted to say, who you wanted to say it to? And he went, yeah. And I just pushed him, I went, go and do it, you know what I mean? And he went on, and he did a great gig, because he went back to that place. Yeah. Again, I'm not sure if that answers the question, but that's the best I can do.
That's beautiful advice, though, and I think poetry readings can be amazing and electric when poets, I think, can capture that emotion they felt when they were writing it. And the opposite is also true, isn't it? Yeah. So it's good advice.
Thank you. A question from here.
Thank you both for being here. To expand on that, what specific ways do your political beliefs affect what and how you write?
For me, it's not about political beliefs. At the moment, I'm not really sure what I believe. I think when I was young, I was told that when you get older, you'd mellow. And I'm 58 now, and I'm almost 59, and I just seem to be getting more militant and more angry, and I want teared on Babylon and mashed on Babylon. But for me, in my poetry, it's not so much about my beliefs, although my work is very political, it's just about the condition we're in. Going back to the Bob Marley quote, Bob Marley just didn't understand the question. He said, politics? I'm writing about the conditions we live in. Now, back in the day, and I think it's relevant now, if you were in Jamaica, or even in Handsworth, and you were being policed badly and living in a bad situation, and you wrote poetry about the birds and the bees and about wonderful, beautiful things that you don't have any access to, the community would look at you and you was on stage, you were on television, and you did a poem about daffodils. We're getting beat up. No. You know, I mean, seriously, I'm going to tell you what's happening in this country. couple of years ago, we had more deaths in custody than in apartheid South Africa. You know, we have an organisation now in Britain. It's not called the Black Panthers or something like that. It's called Black Lives Matter. It's so simple, because there's a lot of people that think that black lives don't matter. You know, we've just decided that we're not part of Europe anymore. We're just going to float off somewhere and all that kind of stuff. I mean, I don't see it as my political view. I just think we've got to talk about the conditions that we're in. And you cannot help but be political like that. There's a wonderful poet from Jamaica who's passed away now. And she started one of her poems, the first poem in her book, actually. And she says, I am not one of those people that say, I don't deal with politics. Because if I don't deal with politics, politics will deal with me. And I think that's beautiful.
Yes. What about you, Liz?
And true.
That was such a great answer. I think you can only write about things that you really care about. And that might be the way you live, the place you come from, the people you care about, your relationship to the world and society. But I think brilliant, genuine poems come from things that people feel really passionate about. So inevitably, your views and your feelings about what's happening in the world around you is expressed through your work.
Thank you. Yes, question over here. Gentleman in the polo sweater, and then this lady in front. Yeah. Next question. Sorry, I'll go to you next. It's okay.
Hi, my question's for Benjamin. I don't know about you, but since Brexit, I've certainly felt a little bit different when I've been out there going about my business. And I wondered whether you had experienced anything or felt the same kind of feelings that I think I felt, that actually relate back to some of the times that you were talking about in the 70s and 80s, because I share some of those experiences too. And for me, I kind of feel like we're getting closer to those kind of, you know, things that are happening then than perhaps we were at a time moving away. And I think Brexit's kind of focused that. And I just wondered whether, A, you had experienced anything, and B, whether it was enough of an observation from you to actually want to write about something, to just let people know, actually, that things have changed out there. You know, I'm not articulate enough to be able to voice the way I feel, but someone like you, I would look to do that.
Well,
without putting any pressure on you, mate.
Yeah, yeah.
But you know, I'm being very articulate, but I hope you understand what I'm trying to say.
Well, answer to your second question first. I put out records and books kind of when I feel the political or spiritual need to. So they're very, you know. I think since Too Black, Too Strong, I don't know how many years, it's a long time. And my publisher keeps asking me for a new book. And I say, when I feel it, and I'm beginning to feel it now. You know, I live in Lincolnshire, the biggest Brexit vote in the country. Boston, not far from where I live, is the most immigrated town in the country. The day after the vote, somebody was driving past and they said, we're getting rid of the Eastern Europeans, you are next, nigger. Yeah. I have had things said to me in the last few months which were exactly what you say, things that were said to me in the 70s and 80s. I couldn't believe some of the things. I had somebody kind of spit on the ground next to me. Something else happened to me that I just cannot talk about now because it's a police matter. It got that serious. I can't remember the figures, but there's been a rise in racist attacks. You know, I was walking through Spalding the other day and a group of Eastern Europeans came up to me and they said, you are the man from the television. And I said, well, there's also Lenny Henry, you know. You are the man from the television, but they think you have superpowers if you're on television. Please say something about us. some of them had attacks. I said, go to the police. And they said, we can't go to the police, because what you have to understand about those areas, very small, close-knit areas. Yeah. Yeah. He said, if we report this person, we'll see them the next day. And we have to live amongst them. And it's interesting, there was a rise in racist attacks all over the country. Lincolnshire had the biggest Brexit vote and not one racist incident in Lincolnshire. People are scared, you know. So I do feel we've taken many steps backwards and we've just become a more divided nation because of some politics.
Yeah. Yes.
I was going to ask Liz a question, but before that, can I just apologise to Benjamin on behalf of all decent people? That's a very...
Oh, come
very...
on. You don't know.
Liz, when I hear the word, and apart from wanting just another Dudley voice in the room, when I hear the words dialect poetry, my heart sinks a little bit because it's either some sort of pastiche of a language that I never really quite heard when, you know, from Dudley in the Black Country, or it's some sort of nostalgic, sort of romantic view of the past. And I don't want to live in the Black Country Museum.
Come on.
You know, it's all very nice, but that was then. What happens now? How do we keep this sort of language and the heritage alive, but in 2016, not all living, you know, sort of in slums and sort of eating faggots and pies all the time, you know. We've got to move on.
I think people are moving on. And I think that's the exciting thing about being able to use dialect in your work, is that actually it's something alive. You can take old words, lots of poets do, because they're beautiful, and that's a little bit of treasure that we want to carry from the past forward into the future for our children and those generations. But it's what you write about. You might write about now, about your life now, about contemporary people, about their feelings, about their experiences. So I think I understand your fear of the dialect poem, or your unease about the dialect poem. But actually, I think once you get out there and start reading, there's some really amazing, exciting work being made, which takes this treasure from the past but brings it into the now.
But I think we have to... Sorry for interrupting.
No, please.
I think we have to be a little bit careful. You are all here because you either love literature, you love the language we use, you come to listen to Liz, but Benjamin's here, so you're listening to Liz. You know, we have to be very careful. We are very passionate about what we like. Mm. That's why we're all here. There are kids out on the street who think we're all crazy. Mm-hmm. Sitting in here. Mm-hmm. Those are the people we have to reach. Mm-hmm. Folk music is great. I love lots of folk music. I don't know if anybody heard my version of Tamlin, which I did with Peter Gabriel. What did that do? That got a lot of young people interested in old British folklore. So what I would say is what we need now is not just poets. We want a good young rock band or somebody, you know, that comes out of Birmingham, that's also Black Country, who's also proud of the dialect, that can incorporate it, just like Manic Street Preachers did for Welsh or whatever. That's what we really need. Otherwise, we'll just keep talking to each other, and we're in danger of doing what I call a kind of intellectual masturbation, talking about, oh, this thing that kind of we like, it's from the past, and we've got to try and keep it alive. The people that really put fire in it is young people when they come and they mix it up and they mix it with rock and reggae and they take it forward. And I don't know, you know, it can be done. And it's not. And the interesting thing is you can't fake that. That has to happen naturally, yeah. You know, you just have to, some young people have to come along and just do it, feel the need to do it, and just do it naturally without faking it.
One last question from this gentleman here.
Takes a long time. I help train priests.
Sorry?
I help train priests.
Do priests need training?
They do.
I thought God did it all.
he needs help. we use a lot of poetry to do that, because poetry describes places really well. So we use your poem, for example, Soho Road.
All right.
A lot. And I was wondering if...
I never thought it'd be used like that when I was...
Yeah. we all sit around and we reflect on it. It's very beautiful. We do it for Birmingham and the Black Country too, so I'm looking forward to using some of Liz's. But I'm just wondering what the place of spirituality is in your work, and whether you feel places have their own particular spiritualities.
Well... I think I've been talking too much. Do you want to go?
I find that quite a difficult question. Because in a way, for me, I suppose, writing is quite a spiritual practice, writing and reading. It's about being attentive and about being in the moment and about listening and about thinking about the feelings of others and the world and how we move through the world, and how we're kind to each other or unkind to each other. So in a way, the practice itself of being a writer and a reader and a listener is for me a spiritual experience.
I see myself as a spiritual person. Sometimes when I hear people being dogmatic, when it comes to religion, I challenge them. So not long ago, the Society of Black Atheists or something like that wrote to me and said, would I come and speak for them? And I wrote back and said, who told you I'm an atheist? You know, because they may have seen me challenging some religious people. I used to kind of go in Moseley and go to the mosque there and things like that, and just go in and just talk and just say, what do you believe? And when I was a kid, I used to go to church a lot, Pentecostal churches, right? And I've come to... And then I went through a period in my life where I just would visit as many of the holy sites around the world as possible. So, you know, Jordan, Jerusalem, you know, Iraq. And I have to say that I kind of came back... I describe myself as believing in God without religion. I don't know if you ever read Karen Armstrong's work. You know, I really love her work. And so I have a respect for people who are honestly religious and truly, you know, but I have a disrespect for people that misuse it. And I see some people who call themselves religious, but they have no real spiritual aspect. They just think the Bible is a book of rules or whatever the book is, and this is it. But I think spirituality is really important. Now, I meditate. And for me, being close to nature, and being able to meditate, I can meditate anywhere, but being close to nature and meditating is very, very spiritual. And I'm going to stop talking about it now, because I know, and I've talked to a lot of people who've experienced this, that when we talk about it, it can sound a bit mumbo-jumbo, it can sound a bit hippie-ish or whatever. It's something you have to experience. You know, you just have to experience it. But it's a really beautiful thing. I don't think that we have a spirit. Follow me. I don't think that we have a spirit. I think we are a spirit with a body attached. Yeah. And so I want to get back to that spirit. And my frustration is that I've not been able to connect that into my poetry. I've used it to help me write poetry. And I'll tell you what I've done. I remember when I was in Birmingham, actually, and I wrote a poem called It Happens Every Day, and it was just about the murders and the Biafran war that was happening at the time and all these things. And I wrote it so quickly, and it was such a long poem, and it was as if a spirit took over me. And it was never published properly, but I found it when I looked back at it. I wrote that when I was so young. again, I feel it's difficult to talk about because it was as if a spirit took over me. And I was making prophecies and all kinds of things in this poem, you know. And there's no way I can explain it, you know. And I'm hesitating to talk about it because I wouldn't talk about it in public normally because I just think it's a very personal thing and it can sound a bit crazy. But I would really love one day to be able to really express my spirituality through poetry. When I can do that, I think I've really become a real grown-up poet.
Right, thank you very much.
Thank you so much to Ursula for prompting this conversation, for your wonderful questions, and for Liz and Benjamin for being honest, so honest, more honest than maybe you wish to be. It's been, as we so often have at the Birmingham Literature Festival, an unpredictably special evening, and it's been great that you could share it with us. Both Liz and Benjamin will be happy to sign copies of their books. We're going to put a table on the stage here, so form an orderly queue at some point. The books are on sale just outside. Do take a look at our brochure if you've not already seen it. There are plenty of other festival events coming up. And if you are interested in language and dialect and how we use it, we're doing a special event with Michael Rosen on Sunday at the mailbox at the BBC from 3 until 5. You can bring along any language which you use, which you think has got some family background or regional background, which you'd like to have investigated by Michael Rosen and Ursula. And we're going to look at the origins of those words we use every day. So send along your words or bring your words in person. That's going to be a fabulous event, which will become a radio programme later on in the year. But it just remains for me to ask you once again to please thank our three guests, Ursula, Benjamin and Liz.